Thank you so much for coming out on this Friday to proceed, hopefully, a very nice Saturday. We're not going to talk about Sunday's weather. We're not going to talk about it. It's my privilege to be a mental health professional. I got licensed back in 2001 and do have a small private practice up in Matthews. The majority of my work is doing independent evaluations for temporary detention order hearings. Love that work. I think that's probably has a lot to do with me cutting my clinical teeth as an emergency services counselor. One of my first supervisors told me, if you can do emergency services, you can do anything. So I haven't proved them wrong yet. I'll try anything and do my best at it and do it in an ethical way. I really want to thank Williamsburg Place and the Farley Lecture Series for giving me this opportunity. Ethics is one of the topics that I'm really passionate about. I'm by no means an expert. And the great thing about ethics to me is that you don't have to be an expert. You just have to keep asking questions. You just have to keep digging. You just have to keep your mind open, you know, your eyes bright, your heart full, and your thoughts clear. And you know, some of our goals today, one of them is talking about establishing or enhancing your ethics consultation network. And that's one of the things I want to hopefully inspire you guys to do. Get one if you don't have one, and enhance the one you've got if you do have one. So I've got Ms. Kirsten, who has graciously agreed to scribe for me. Now would be the time. And I've got a little mnemonic for ethics that I've just kind of come up with. And so probably if you come over here so they can see that side of it. Yeah, that's great. So the E in ethics, two words that come to mind are ethics are essential and ethics should be encouraging. You know, ethics don't need to be sticks that beat us in line. Ethics should encourage us and be essential in our minds. Ethics should be thoughtful, okay? And they should be tenable. They should be pragmatic. They should be things we can actually do. For the H, I've got heuristic, meaning they should have heuristic value, H-E-U-R-I-S-T-I-C, I think. Any spelling bee champs in the room? Okay. What she said? H-E-U-R-I-S. Okay, there you go. M-I-C-K-E-Y. Okay, no. I'm getting off track already. So heuristic in that they inspire further development, further study, further research. Ethics should also be helpful along with heuristic. And they should help us. They should help the people we serve. They should help the organizations we work for. For the I, I've got implicit. Ethics should be implicitly understood as part of our daily practice, whether we prescribe, we give bedside direct care, we give talk therapy, we give play therapy, whatever we do. We're marketers, we're nurses, whatever. The ethics should be implicit. Ethics are also important. And I feel ethics, good ethics, should be inspiring. They should inspire us to do our best work in the best way possible at all times. You're doing such a good job, Kirsten. I know you don't have much to work with on this end, but you're doing a good job. For the C, I've got ethics should be creative, because ethics need to be responsive to the practice that we engage in and the folks that we serve, our customers, our patients, our clients, our consumers. Ethics should be cognizant, C-O-G-N-I-Z-A-N-T. I don't mean to be insulting, but somebody had to tell me how to spell it one time, and I never forgot. N-I-Z-A-N-T. Is that right? Is that right, spelling bee? Okay, good. I'm sorry. Just And they should also be conspicuous, right? They should be conspicuous. They should be apparent in our practice. They should be apparent to the people that pay us, to the people that we treat, to our colleagues, to our boards. When we're looked at, they should be conspicuous. And lastly, ethics should be supportive of our work. I'm sorry, I know that's at the bottom there. What a trooper. Ethics should be salient. They should be obvious. They should be just there. Is there a bird tweeting? Is that somebody's phone? That's kind of a cool ringtone, actually. And they should be service-oriented. They should serve us. They should serve the people we work with. They should serve our counterparts. So would everybody agree with these aspects of ethics, these adjectives? Okay. Thank you, Kirsten. Fantastic job. Let's hear it for Kirsten. Yay! All right. I do want to say that I have much respect and awareness and sensitivity to the fact that we all have different disciplines. We were trained at different times. We're in different roles and functions. We have different parameters under which we must function based on where we work or our experience or qualifications. And I want to be sensitive to that. So much of what I'm talking about today is in a broad brush way. And sometimes when I interject something that seems, God, that's really opinionated, Brian, it's because it's my opinion. And I've got a disclaimer about that, so it's okay, it's ethical. What attracted me to ethics, and I was sharing this with one of my new friends, and it's sure great to see so many familiar faces here and so many new faces. I've made a lot of new friends today, and appreciate you guys coming out. But what I was sharing a little while ago is that what attracted me to ethics was the same thing that attracted me to behavioral health, that it's a little bit nebulous and abstract. That many times there are different paths that can lead to a good or reasonable or acceptable outcome. That it's not yes, no, black, white, stop, go. It's the other thing that I think is important about ethics and behavioral health care is the process is, to me, is just as important as the outcome, the process that you go through. And that becomes particularly important if something that you've done gets analyzed by some of the wonderful people in Richmond that give us the right to practice our craft, and they come looking, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later. So got a little joke for you to kind of describe a little bit about ethics and everything. So a physician and a lawyer were at a party, and they were two of the only kind of licensed people that were there. It was like a cocktail party, and people kept coming up to the physician and asking for free advice. You know, oh, doc, you know, I got this thing back here, and all this stuff. Nobody came up to the attorney. And so after about an hour, you know, the doctor asked the attorney, he said, you know, why didn't anybody, you know, I'm getting hijacked for all this free curbside consult stuff here. Why didn't anybody ask you anything? And he said, it's very simple. He said, the first time somebody did that, he said, the next Monday when I got back to work, I sent them a bill, consultation fee, $150. Physician said, man, that's fantastic. That's brilliant. We'll try that. So physician gets to his office Monday morning and has a bill for $150 from the attorney. And I think as behavioral health care or medical professionals, we often get solicited for free advice. And I think there's some ethical trappings to that whole dynamic. So hopefully I'll address some of them too. Because, you know, many times we are seen as what we do for a living, even though that's just part of us. It's one aspect of us. For many people, in many people's eyes, we can never take that mantle off, for better or worse. And I think many of us know that. And if you don't believe that, please consider believing that, because in many people's eyes, it is the case. I mean, you think about, you know, if you worship in a faith congregation and that person that's, you know, the head, you know, spiritual leader, you know, rabbi, priest, cleric, preacher, Monsignor, they can never escape that role, and we're in a similar quandary as behavioral health care professionals. So just a little bit of housekeeping overview. Goals of today's training: we want to identify some ethical challenges that we deal with. We want to identify a challenge that causes us the most concern, and that's something you do and keep to yourself, but I think it's important to know what maybe one or two hot button issues are for you so you can plan ahead. And also begin to talk about enhancing or further developing or creating an ethical consultation network. We do have some case studies that actually are printed in the handout that we're going to do kind of as a collective group talk, group think, and I'm going to lean on the wonderful Kirsten to help me jot down some of the things that you guys shout out at the end. So we're going to do that about 10:45. And this is a full contact audience participation endeavor. So buckle your seatbelt and enjoy. I promise it'll be entertaining. I hope it'll be informative, and I pray it'll be educational. So what are ethics and why are they important? So basically, for you guys, if you just want to blurt stuff out, Kirsten, would you mind? Because I have a hard time walking and chewing gum. So just some one-word adjectives. I mean, you can use some that we used before, or you can, you know, what ethics mean to you, or just something short that Kirsten can write. What are ethics? What are they?
Guidelines.
Standards.
Boundaries.
Boundaries. Good. I like that. I like guidelines.
Values.
Values, good. Okay. Very good. Anything else? I think that that's all. Everything's correct there.
Boundaries.
Truth. Is that okay? Yes, sir.
Mindfulness.
Very good. Awareness, consciousness, the whole cognizant aspect I was talking about. Yep, absolutely.
Protection.
They definitely are. They're great insurance. To me, ethics are a comfort. You know, they're comforting. So, along with protection and guidelines and morals and truth and mindfulness, they're a comfort. Okay, no, that's great. I think all of that's correct. Awesome. Anything else quickly before we move on?
No.
Okay. First and so wonderful. Oh, we're like two lunches now. So the roots of ethics. So to me, you know, go back to Hippocrates in ancient Greece, I think it was, do no harm or non-malfeasance, okay? So at the end of the day, when we practice our craft, we may not have fixed or solved or even been very helpful, but don't make things worse, right? I mean, don't, you know, leave it as good as you found it, if not better. That's what Mom always said. Put it back like you found it, you know? So do no harm. So that's the non-malfeasance aspect. The second slide down there I really like, that's the beneficence aspect of ethics. So I believe ethics is at least two-pronged in a very broad brush sense. Non-malfeasance, Hippocratic Oath, and beneficence. So beneficence is do all the good you can in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as you ever can. John Wesley said that. Got a little plaque with that in my office. And I just love that. I just think that, you know, we're clearly not in this for the money. We're in it for, you know, we're helpers and healers. We're in it to take care of people, you know, to hopefully leave people as good or better than we found them when they walked into our lives. Ethics versus law. Very rhetorical questions. Is everything ethical also legal? Correct. I agree with that 100%. Is everything legal automatically ethical? Wow. Lots of times, yeah. It is ethical to obey laws, but it may be ethical to protest testifying in court if you do not have, you know, written consent and that type of thing. But there are other things that you can do. There are mechanisms that you can use to attempt to avoid doing that. And your own ethical, you know, soul needs to speak to, are you willing to go to jail? You know, and I've been pretty close one time, and it was kind of a scary time, and it was worked out, and the person that was involved was very grateful, and it was very much a learning curve for me, and I had a lot of people that I used my ethics consultation team, which that wasn't what I called them then. I called them my supervisors and my coworkers and my go-to people, and they coached me through it, and we got with the folks and the attorneys, and everything worked out. Doesn't always happen like that. So a bit on the purpose and utility of ethics over on page 3. So we talked about this a little bit already. We were kind of alluding to some of the different aspects. So, to give us consistency, some expectations. So when somebody comes to a licensed clinical psychologist for testing, they can at least look up the APA guidelines on ethics or have a brief discussion, or hopefully the psychologist has a brief discussion with them, and they talk about this is what you can expect from me in some key different areas. And I always have that pre-services or pre-relationship conversation, and I document it in written form. I have basically a treatment contract that I use with folks, and it talks about all the duty to warn and adult protective services and child protective services and possible court subpoenas and things I'll do. And it's basically, you know, in services licensed by the Department of Behavioral Health, they have patient rights, client rights. Well, I have this thing I call client rights and responsibilities, because I feel like to enter into a relationship, it needs to be two-sided. They have expectations of me, I have expectations of the folks I work with. And I just, you know, really, in a very egalitarian way, look at the relationship that way and say, look, you know, if we're gonna work together and do good stuff, there's some things I need from you, and here they are. And let's talk about them, and let's get questions answered before we, you know, form the bond of a therapeutic relationship. And, you know, there's been times that people have gotten up from that conversation and said, I don't think I can work with you. And I said, you know, thank you so much, because I'd rather know now than 4 or 5 sessions in. Professionalism certainly set us apart from folks that are not licensed or are not ascribed to a certain practice or field or don't have ethics. Interesting. How many folks know that beginning next July 1, so July 1, 2017, that Medicaid is going to recognize certified peer recovery specialists as providers? Anybody know that? Good job. One of the first things that they did after they created the curriculum to certify peers, so of course people with a lived experience, they created a curriculum for them, they're grandfathering some folks in, but they created a code of ethics, a very nice code of ethics that is very consistent with the codes of ethics that all of us in this room ascribe to. You know, it's got things about confidentiality and dual relationships and just a lot of different areas are covered and how to handle crises and things like that. And I was just really proud of that because that's another area that I feel very strongly about is people that have lived experiences providing services, whether it be from chairing a 12-step meeting or from, you know, peer services in a more traditional peer recovery specialist sense. You know, I think that's really strong. I think that's it's a 12th step in AA and NA, you know. And so why can't behavioral health also have a 12th step in a way? So it's also self and professional regulation that was mentioned earlier, guidelines and standards. And also standardization, so guiding principles. So those are at least some of my thoughts on the purpose and utility or usefulness or pragmatism of ethics. Okay, so some common ethical tenets shared among medical and mental health providers. This is by no means an exhaustive list, but just some that I thought would be important to bring up today. So confidentiality, okay, and there's certain occasions when we can and have to break confidentiality. But again, that informing the consent of the patient before you enter the relationship with them is key in being able to stay out of jail, be ethical, and provide good service. So I like to do all three every day. So dual relationships, one thing that was very interesting to me when I did some research on dual relationships was that some of the different boards had different guidelines about dual relationships. And I just jotted a few down. I'll just hit this kind of quick. It's not in your handout. So the American Counseling Association, so how about a romantic relationship? Well, ACA, APA, and NASW all say no, comma. ACA says for 5 years, and if you decide to, then you must document the potential for exploitation of the patient. My personal code of ethics, no, not ever, not never. APA says not for 2 years, but then you have to document the exploitation potential. It's kind of shocking to me. NASW says no, and if you do, you must demonstrate that there's no exploitation going on. And again, the burden of proof being on the practitioner. It's always on us. It's always on us because we're seen as in a one-up position and having to ensure the safety and all of that of the people we work with. How about non-professional interactions? This is like business or going to faith congregation meetings together or being in the Kiwanis together, I guess. I don't know. ACA, avoid it unless there's a potential benefit to the client, and you have to document that benefit. APA, it's okay unless it impairs the psychologist's ability to be objective or it exploits or hurts the patient. Again, document, burden of proof on us. Social work, it's okay if you set boundaries. If there's a risk of exploitation or harm, then it's not okay, you can't do it. So it's not like if there's a risk, you have to document it and say what you're gonna do to protect from it. It's like if there is a risk, you can't do it. Really curious how they don't line up more closely to me about dual relationships. Receiving gifts. Counselors need to take into account the relationship, the motivation of the client, the value, the therapeutic implications of rejecting the gift, et cetera. Bottom line, I mean, if somebody brings me, you know, a dozen chocolate chip cookies, I'm going to set them on, you know, the table in the church where I have my practice, and the ladies' circle or whoever's next there is going to get to eat them. And I'm going to say thank you very much. APA and NASW, social work is actually mute on the issue of receiving gifts, to the best of my knowledge. APA says avoid it unless it's going to offend them by rejecting the gift. Well, I don't know how it could not offend somebody if you try to give them. Anyway, bartering. Okay, so I work in a rural area. I work in Gloucester Matthews area, so, you know, pretty rural. And although I haven't had anybody show up with a live chicken for payment for services rendered, I'm certainly prepared for that day. Actually, I covered that in the pre-relationship conversation. So anyway, Counselors, it's okay as long as it's not exploitive, if there's no unfair advantage to the therapist or the counselor, as long as the client initiates it, and if it is an accepted practice in the area that you're working in. So I'm thinking like Alaska, you know, Montana, places like that, maybe, you know, a little more out of necessity and common, and you do have to discuss and document the implications of it, though. So I don't know how you equate, you know, dozen eggs or a pound of butter to an hour of therapy, but I'm sure there's a formula somewhere. Psychologist, it's okay if it's not clinically contraindicated or exploitive to the patient. So I would say if it's a painter and you're seeing them for marital therapy and you make them paint your whole house for one counseling session, that's probably exploitive, you know. And again, document and prove, you know, burden of proof on us. And then social work, avoid bartering unless it's an accepted practice in your community that it's essential for the services, meaning I guess there's no other way they could pay for it, right? No coercion, client initiates it and gives informed consent, and social worker has the burden of proof for making sure that all those boxes are checked. So kind of curious, right? I mean, just there's a lot of variance there. And I just took one aspect, and I think, you know, one of the things that you know, is probably the most, you know, controversial or gets the most press when somebody does fall off the ethical wagon, you know, a dual relationship is very scandalous. And one of the things that you can get in the most trouble for the quickest with your board, and rightly so. So another common ethical tenet, competence and scope of expertise. Now, I'm a big fan of Marsha Linehan, dialectical behavior therapy. I'm by no means an expert, and I would by no means attempt to call myself an expert or attempt to run a DBT group or, you know, that sort of thing. I have used some of her worksheets that I feel comfortable and competent in using, but I'm by no means a certified or even experienced or competent DBT practitioner. There are many different, you know, genres and species of therapeutic help out there that are branded and some that aren't. And I would say, again, the burden of proof is on us if we put ourselves out there or even if we practice a certain technique or strategy, you know, with someone to make sure that we are clinically competent in it. And so, you know, you can do, you know, a lot of harm if you're not, obviously. And I just think it's just not worth the risk. It's just really not worth the risk. And if what you're saying that you do or what you're doing has some type of certification or something that goes along with it, get it, because it's just not worth it. Because that's a little bit more affirmation proof positive. Now, there's people that have certifications that, competence, but at least it's one step in the right direction, right? So anyway, that's my two cents on competence and scope of expertise. And certainly never let your reach exceed your grasp when you're using some techniques or strategies or a school of counseling. Mandated reporting, again, in that initial pre-relationship conversation talking about, you know, duty to warn and protective services and subpoenas and, well, that's not mandated reporting, but duty to warn and protective services, talking about those things. Abandonment of care. That's one that I think probably happens more than a lot of people realize. So you've got a patient and you take Blue Cross and everything's lovely and you're working with them and all of a sudden they lose their insurance. What do you do? So many places have very detailed practices in their pre-relationship conversation memo or letter or whatever that says, in the event you should lose your insurance, you'll be fully responsible for your payment. But what if they can't pay? I mean, you can't just cut them off and drop them. I mean, that's not ethical in my view. And so, you know, what I've done basically, you know, is seen people gratis until I could connect them with another provider that they could, you know, access reasonably. Now, access reasonably doesn't mean I'm going to see you free every week for 6 months. It's different with everybody. It's different with every issue. You need to look at the context of the relationship and what's going on. And you may be able to just finish things up with them and say, look, if you need care again in the future and you don't have insurance, these are some resources. You know, yes, licensed people, we are allowed to do case management type things, and that's very therapeutic and appropriate work. So impaired professionals and impairments of all types, chemical, I think, is the one that comes to mind most obvious. Psychological impairment, you know, we work in often meat grinder conditions or at least dealing with meat grinder type topics and that are really tough and that take something out of us. So being able to recharge our batteries and debrief and depressurize and stay healthy between our ears is extremely important. You know, it's kind of like the person that was drowning and the lifeguard goes out to save them, and the lifeguard's not a strong swimmer and two people drowned. So we got to be a strong lifeguard, right? We got to, you know, rule the pool, so to speak. We've got to make sure we're airtight and pressurized and ready for action at all times. Not perfect, not walking on water, but emotionally and mentally healthy. Reporting of known unethical behavior. This is a really interesting topic. I was taught by Mary Alice Fisher. Many of you guys know Dr. Fisher practices out of Charlottesville and Center for Ethical Practice, and Dr. Michael Gillette out of Lynchburg, Center for Bioethical Studies, that like licensed people have an obligation to report unethical behavior of counterparts, but they have an opportunity to report unethical behavior of differently licensed counterparts, you know. LPC has to report LPC. LPC may or may not report a LCSW. Well, I've never reported anybody. I'm willing to, but anytime I've had a concern, I've gone to that person. And sometimes I've had to go to them more than once and with another colleague the second time and say, look, help me understand this. I want to learn something here. I mean, I go with a lot of humility and respect because I don't want them to get jammed up. And anytime somebody does an ethical miscue, falls off the ethical wagon, it splashes back on all of us. I mean, it really does. I feel it does. And so if damage is done or something like that, that may avert that person that was affected receiving services from ever getting help again. I mean, how sad. I mean, that just breaks my heart, really. So reporting of known unethical behavior. Conflicts of interest, you know, can be of all types and sizes. I generally try to stay really high and dry away from any conflict of interest. You know, I've had people offer me, you know, football tickets to UVA or Virginia Tech games and, you know, oh, you know, we just really like you and stuff like that. It's like, well, no, I can do a dozen cookies. I got an answer for that, but, you know, football tickets, you know, that's kind of a lot of money and, you know, I really appreciate the gesture and maybe I would suggest you donate them to a charity or raffle them off and give the money to, you know, the Boys and Girls Club or something like that. I mean, that's kind of how I handle that. And hopefully I do that in an eloquent way that doesn't piss them off or disrespect them or insult them. But I just really stay high and dry on that because there's this unknown expectation, if not opportunity, for a quid pro quo. So, like, if you give me these tickets, like, what do I owe you? You're like, when are you going to cash that chip in? And people are people. And it's going to come around to haunt you. And I just, high and dry, that's where I try to stay. Couple of other ones, failure to properly refer out or terminate services. So maybe services are really, you know, you guys are just chatting at this point, okay? It's like your cup of coffee at 7 on Wednesday with Maury or something. And it's really, you know, the work is done, you know? And it's I guess, tempting. And, you know, I've grown fond of folks that I've worked with too, but, you know, in a professional way and said, okay, feels like we're done here. You know, let's look at closing, let's look at terminating. Or maybe some things are emerging that are beyond your reach, beyond your scope of expertise. I have treated folks that were also being treated by somebody else. It's so much heavy lifting involved to do a good job of coordination of care and eliminate splitting and stuff. I try to avoid it. I try to say, look, you know, it seems like these issues, in my view, are kind of driving the bus right now. And so perhaps you could go and get these addressed and hear a couple of referrals, again, that old case management thing. And, you know, I would be happy to work with you again, you know, once these are a little bit better under control, but I don't think I can be effective in this area. These are some people I think can be, and I would like an opportunity to work with you again. And so that, I think, is a very respectful, ethical way to handle that. Confidentiality as related to psychiatric emergencies. So let's say you're seeing a patient in your private practice, and Colonial CSB is pre-screening them for temporary detention order for possible involuntary hospitalization. And they call your answering service, and lo and behold, you just drew the short straw and you're on call this weekend, and you know this patient. Can you talk to that CSB clinician? How many people think you can? Yeah, okay. How many people think you can't?
You can ask if they've got a release.
Emergency, psych emergencies trump all of that. Now, begs the question, that's the law. That's HIPAA. That's coordination of care, that's psych emergency, that's, in other words, you look at this, you do this risk-reward thing. The danger of not communicating may cause greater harm than the danger of communicating. And if somebody has put themselves in that posture, I mean, that's a pretty urgent, emergent psych status, right? I mean, either a law enforcement officer said, you're coming with me to be evaluated, or a family member's petitioned a magistrate or something like that has happened. So actually you can, and that's you know, very representative of a few folks said, yeah, you can talk to them. And I think less is more. I think, you know, tell them what they need, answer questions, tell them critical things, but the name of their dog when they were 5 years old is probably not important, meaning I don't think you need to be very verbose with how much you share, but you need to give that clinician enough to do their job. You need to give that clinician enough to do their job. Because it's your patient that's in crisis, and here's this other clinician that's out there, you know, handling it. And I would say even offering to be involved in as much as is appropriate and you're available and that sort of thing. Emergency services is incredibly tough work. They have to do a really tough, risky job with very limited resources, often in the dead of night, with uncooperative partners and players and all of that. So hats off to those guys. Accidental contacts and disclosures. True story. I'm in Walmart. It's about 15 years ago. It's Lynchburg, Virginia, where I was born and raised. I had been doing emergency services, and I had probably about 6 weeks earlier detained a young lady that was suicidal, had done some stuff and was intoxicated and, you know, fill in the blanks. And so her significant other, her paramour, great big old country boy, is also shopping at Walmart at that time. And as I'm making my way to the door with my bags, he comes up to me and says, hey, aren't you that guy that, whatever your beliefs may be, I know the Lord was with me at that moment, because I said, sir, this is neither the time nor the place. I wish you well. Have a good evening. And walked off. I mean, it wasn't me saying that. It was like some other voice came out of my body, thankfully. And he just kind of stood there stunned, because he was looking for, you know. So had I talked to him, obviously not good, even if they're okay with it, because I've had people come to me at Walmart and go, oh, yeah, you remember you were talking to me about that, you know, and it is really a good idea, and I do this. And I'm like, you know what? No, because this is your private information. You may not care, but I'm uncomfortable. We need to stop this conversation. Matter of fact, in my little pre-counseling conversation, I even say, if I see you in public and you say hi to me, I'll say hi back, but I won't initiate hi. I'm not being rude, but people know who I am. Not that I'm somebody, but some people know what I do, and I don't want somebody to infer that you're in treatment. And most people really appreciate that. Continued professional development, I think, is an ethical concern. I remember one of my instructors in graduate school saying the saddest thing to them was a teacher that retired after 23 years with only 1 year's experience. Do you know what I'm talking about? They got their 1 year's experience and they never grew. They didn't put down deep, wide roots. And I think, you know, as professionals, I think that's critical that we stay, you know, state of the art and know what's going on and know what trends are. And you know, we were talking earlier about the opiate epidemic, and you know, it was spice, and you know, just all the things that are going on that are insulting and impacting the folks we work with in our field. So continued professional development, I think, is a very ethical thing, very essential ethical thing to not do that. And you all guys are great. You're all doing it right now. You know, is real important. And then the dynamics of the therapeutic relationship, I think, are some things that we need to think about, because there may be somebody that we are working with that really looks like this person we used to date that we really still kind of have some unfinished business with. And so what does that mean, and how does that impact the relationship, and what do you do about that? Again, rhetorical question, but asking yourself those questions and having that consciousness and awareness is critical. To keep everybody safe and to give good product, give good service, do good work. Also, if the patient becomes enamored with you, because many times, you know, you're this riding in like the cavalry, white horse, and, you know, saving the day, and, oh, God, you've been so helpful, and, oh, it's just wonderful, and, you know, you're the only person that can help me, and, you know, that's like a axis to diagnostic indicator right there, but anyway. You know, you just got to be aware of that, and you just got to own that stuff and speak to it and call them out on it in a respectful, therapeutic way. Well, no, you've done a lot of work. I'm like a coach. I tell them, you know, even Tiger Woods or, you know, Joe Namath or whoever, you know, Bart Starr, these guys all had coaches. They were at the top of their game, but they had coaches. And so I'm like, think of me as a coach. I'm not a life coach. I don't have that certification, but think of our relationship as resembling coaching. because you know what's going on. You're the expert on you. I've worked with people with similar issues, and I can maybe point you in some directions. You're the one that's going to be working. I'm going to be assisting you, coaching you, you know, saying more or less, faster, slower. Here's some things to think about. Here's some things to do. So some statistics, and we're just a couple minutes from a break, from the boards of health professions. And I actually got them up here. I'm just going to rattle them off. So the Board of Counseling, six-month period, July through December 2015. They received 45 complaints. This is Virginia. They had 108 complaints open at the end of that period. New Year's Eve, they had 108 complaints open. They closed 42. Two of their actions were mandatory suspensions of licenses. They had two cases of healthcare fraud that were actually turned over to law enforcement for felonies, and those people were subjected to, those clinicians were subjected to jail time. One of those folks got federal prison time. What does that mean? It was probably Medicare. Yeah. Board of Psychology received 37 complaints during the period, just for context, a few less than Board of Counseling. They had 84 open cases, and they closed 20 cases. They also had two actions. A terminated license was reinstated, and it was due to, and then somebody that was previously unable to practice safely was reinstated. That was found previously unable to practice safely was proved to the board that they were able to practice safely. Board of Medicine, much more robust numbers, obviously. 612 complaints in 6 months, just in Virginia. And I mean, this is not veterinary medicine. This is like DOMD, you know, okay. 582 open complaints. God, I'd hate to work there. And they closed 745 complaint cases during that six-month period. So they closed like 120 a month, something like that. Board of Social Work, fairly consistent with Board of Counseling. 53 complaints, 126 open cases at the end of the period, and 8 were closed. So just some food for thought. And I got all of those off the internet. Department of Health Professions, the respective board, so you can certainly look those up. It's kind of sobering and interesting at the same time. All right. So we've talked about a couple of these over on page 4. I don't see anybody giving me the high sign for a break. You guys want to take a break now? Now's a good breaking time. It's been about 45 or 50 minutes. Who wants to take a break? Who wants to go about 5 or 10 more minutes? Break? Break. Okay. If you guys can be back at certainly by 10. All right. Thank you so much. Well, I learned a lot during the Lord be with you. Yes. Okay. All right. Yeah, that usually does kind of quiet people down because kind of a lot of programming, conditioning going on there. Anyway, thanks for coming back together. So we're going to go ahead. I learned a couple things during the break. I learned that I wasn't using the PowerPoint, but I also learned that you guys had this, and your resourcefulness is exceeded only by your ethical standards. Yeah, I'll try to be better about that. Okay, I'll be better about that. Thank you. Met a lot of nice people and really appreciate all you guys coming out. Some historically common ethical concerns among healthcare providers. We already hit dual relationships, abandonment of care, practicing beyond scope. How about diagnostic reimbursement challenges? What on earth am I talking about there? It's actually one of our case studies. You know, on inpatient psych, schizoaffective disorder, bipolar type pays better than adjustment disorder. Go figure. But you need, you know, a rose by any other name would smell as sweet, and you need to call it what you see it. Yes, sir?
Well, this isn't about diagnostic reimbursement exactly, but it is a diagnostic issue.
Uh-huh.
I think it is an ethical issue.
Okay. Right.
Major depression, but if it goes into the record and somebody sees it, that could cause them maybe to have their insurance premiums go higher. So you put it down as pervasive depressive disorder. Okay, so I think that's something that people do. So it's in a sense it's for the client's benefit, but it's an honest and ethical. It's like that's a hard way of sometimes.
And I think each of us is challenged to ethically square ourselves with that kind of dilemma. And you know, I know where I come down on it, and each of us has to make up their mind. And again, that pre-relationship conversation, I say, you know, we got a couple of ways we can go here. if you've got insurance and I'm on your panel, I'm obligated to, you know, treat you under those terms. But if you don't have insurance, then, you know, the records and the information is between you and I, and those few exceptions where court and mandated things kick in. And so that's why in my small private practice, I'm off all insurance panels. I take no insurance. I do cash only. And so it's got a lot of benefits. And I'm not, you know, that good or that cocky or anything. It's just I'm that simple. And I'm that aware that just the issue you just brought up, I mean, it's going to affect your life insurance premiums. It's going to affect the loading of your future insurance premiums, your risk analysis by any type of fiduciary, you know, insurance company. Yeah, thank you. Yes, ma'am.
The other side of that same issue, if we underdiagnose, you know, we're looking now at an atmosphere where people are trying to limit access to firearms, for example, for somebody who has a serious mental health history. And if you, as the provider, don't identify what you're really seeing, that can have an effect in the future for that person, too.
And that's a huge ethical and legal and moral and everything else dilemma. And again, that's what I love about ethics. We've all got to get square with what's ethically right for us, within the confines of standardized ethical practice for our craft, within the laws of the land, and with what price we're willing to pay with. And we need to think about, and this gentleman reminded me during the break, he said, you know, a good way to look at things is who's benefiting. And I think that's just brilliant. Who's benefiting from this transaction, from this conversation, from this diagnosis, from this relationship? Who stands to gain? And perhaps also the converse, who stands to lose? And what do they stand to lose? So I do have that, you know, I don't do any insurance, and I do gratis patients, and, you know, I basically, you know, share with them that, you know, there's a lot of advantages for you and me to not, you know, use your insurance, and because I'm not on your panel, because I'm not on any panels, I don't have to, so I'm not bound by that. And some people say, you know, I've really got to use my insurance, and really what I charge is pretty close to what their copay is anyway, and once they realize that, they usually come back. So anyway, That's the way I got ethically square with the insurance companies. I divorced them from my life. So. Well, I don't know if it was well done, but it's certainly interesting. But, okay, we talked about confidentiality, particularly in emergency situations. I want to make sure you guys are aware that if there is an emergent situation, an ER doc, another healthcare provider, basically, okay, emergency services clinician at the community service board, something like that, you can and should communicate enough for effective care to be delivered, in my opinion. And it is supported by HIPAA. Informed consent. Man, you drive a truck through that. So what does that mean? To me, it means somebody can communicate and maintain choice, somebody can understand relevant information, and somebody can understand the risk and benefits of the options in front of them, at a minimum. And that's actually one of the little things on the independent evaluation form that I have to evaluate when I see folks that are on TDOs. So that's pretty front and center in my mind. That pre-relationship conversation is where you inform their consent. And if at any time something emerges and you think they may have forgotten some of that informed consent conversation, I think it's very appropriate to say, now, hold on, let me cut you off. I just want to remind you of the talk we had when we first started working. It's been a while now, so you may, you know, I'm just want to remind you so that they know what they're about to say, what impact it may have on them, what they may gain or lose, or what position they may put you in by what they say. Continued professional development, we've talked about that. Self-care, we talked about that. I would certainly say that we all... probably as much, if not more, than most other people, probably right up there with emergency room personnel and rescue squad and law enforcement and everything, need to practice great self-care all the time, holistically, physically, intellectually, emotionally, spiritually, in all ways, whatever that means to you. And you, guess what? You get to say what that means. But if you're starting to tell people to go fly a kite that don't deserve to be told that, you may be getting a little burnt out. So that's kind of my little barometer is, you know, and... Actually, my wonderful wife, who was sitting right by Kirsten and left because she was dealing with some stuff, is excellent for that, too. So life partners are excellent barometers for when you need to do some self-care. So lean on them as an ethical provider. Inadequate treatment of patient. Again, we kind of talked about that, practicing beyond scope. It could also be hanging on to somebody, you know, when the work is clearly done. So a progression of ethics sanctions, and this is pretty much in order, best of my understanding, what I've observed and seen over the years. Warning, which can be written or verbal. Formal citation. Then you go before a board. Remediation, so they'll send you to bad boy, bad girl school. You'll have to take some ethics credits or, you know, something like that, or depending on what it is. Or you may have to take a class in a certain thing, you know, because maybe you had a deficit there. A financial fine or some type of other restitution that you have to make to repatriate the error that you committed. Suspension of your license, which you can apply for and get back, or revocation. That's kind of like when you get 15 DUIs and they say, you're never driving in this state again, boy. So that's kind of revocation, and that's usually fairly permanent. You're an accomplished person if you can get things remedied and overcome a revocation. And then, again, as I mentioned in some of the charges of the Board of Counsel last year with the fraud, your board can give assistance to the legal system to result in criminal charges and jail time for you. So, I mean, all of that's, you know, at risk. And the neat thing about the information age and technology is all of this is online. You can look up you can look up yourself, you can look up other providers, you can look up your PCP, and if there's been anything in painful detail, including scans of the original documentation, they will be on there in little PDF files. So any of those activities results in the license lookup aspect of your board site documenting that. And some things, and I haven't figured out the rhyme or reason, it's probably written down somewhere, some things go off after a certain amount of time, but some things, you know, like luggage, you keep them forever. So hallmarks of ethical practice. So these are just kind of Brian's pearls of wisdom. What would a reasonable person do? And it's kind of a legal thing, too. You know, it's the reasonable person test. I mean, you hear about that sometimes in court matters. You know, at this time, it would be reasonable for somebody to call for medical assistance because there's somebody laying on the ground bleeding from the head. But you failed to do that, so was that negligent? And there's probably a higher standard if you're a nurse or a doctor or a paramedic than there is if you're John Q. Public or Jane Q. Public. One of my favorites, the thing that saved my butt a couple of decades ago when I almost went to jail, discussing the situation with peers and supervisors, and I said those that have more knowledge, but I'd like to rather clarify that and say those that have different knowledge than you do. Because it's not a superiority thing, it's a diversity thing. This is what I used to always tell my staff when I worked Director of Behavioral Health for Bon Secours. Ask yourself, what is the best and worst possible outcome? Or who has to gain and who has to lose? Or how would this look if it was Wavy News 10 on your side, Andy Fox talking about it, or on the front page of the Daily Press? So those are another couple of barometers. And then ask yourself, look in the paper, on the news, or in court. So just kind of, you know, if you can ask yourself those four questions and any others of your own choosing or some combination thereof and still feel good and comfortable and whole and fearless, you're probably okay. If you can't, you probably need to think some more. Or talk to some other people with different, not better experiences. So building an ethics consult resource, I love this. Diversity is the key. With so many things in life, we're hopefully enhanced, but also limited by our experiences. I have very different experiences than some of you guys in this room. I was, you know, born and raised in a small Central Virginia town and, you know, lived there until I got good sense to escape and then move to the beautiful Tidewater area and love it here, loved it there. But I've really expanded my horizons and my thinking and been more mindful. So this is my suggestion. It doesn't have to be all these people, but these are some key elements. At a minimum, I would have somebody that has your same license, whatever that is, okay? Another thing would be, ideally, somebody with a different license. So if you're a psychologist, get a social worker on board. A licensed medical professional. If you've got a doc, that's phenomenal. If you've got a nurse, that's probably even better because they're going to take more time with you. No docs in the room? Any MDs or DOs?
Too late.
Too late. It is. I just wanted to know who to say sorry to, right? Yeah. Clergy. A lot of people don't think about that, but clergy of some type. Doesn't matter what type. You know, but somebody with a faith orientation, because I think ethics and morals and reasonableness and right and wrong, you know, all kind of meld together a little bit, and so having a clergy. We had a ethics team up at Bonsecore Rappahannock where I worked, and I was on the ethics committee, and we had a ethics on-call rotation. And so every month there were like two people that were the key contacts, and you were on call 24/7 if an ethical dilemma came up. And so you always had two very different people. You might have an administrator and a nurse. You might have a social worker and, you know, a department head from like, you know, fiscal or something. And so, because ethical quandaries can take all forms, right? Here's one, a courageous one. Somebody with a lived experience in behavioral health or addictions. Whoa, talk about keeping yourself honest. And it can be somebody that's currently receiving services that's stable, or it can be somebody that has a history of receiving services. They will put a light on your decision-making unlike anybody else can. If you have the luxury of having an ethicist on your consultation team, that's great. A local or facility organization's ethics committee is a good resource also. Certainly your supervisor, because if you're having ethical questions, it's very wise to bring your supervisor in the loop very early. Your coworkers, which I think is a natural. And then other people that are treating the person that the issue concerns. So maybe you have somebody that you do outpatient therapy with or addictions group, and they also go to the community services board for mental health skill building, or they go to the psychosocial day program. So involving some of those people would be reasonable, in my view. Anybody missing? Anybody that y'all currently use that's not represented up there or think should be up there that's not? And again, it doesn't have to be all of those people. That's the Cadillac. You can drive. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you kind of mentioned it in another context, but spouse or life partner.
Yeah.
Not because you're necessarily ethicist, but they know you better and more thoroughly than any other human being on the planet. And they know all the ways you can go down roads and where all the mines can explode.
Spoken like somebody who's had a successful relationship with a life partner. Good job. There you go. See, there's a difference between, I'm going to clap for that. There's a difference between being in a relationship and being happily in a relationship. Anybody can be in a relationship, right? Okay. So, all righty. So, oh, crap. There we go. Building an ethics diversity is the key. Building an ethics consult resource, continued to asking somebody, hey, yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to reinforce what you said about actually asking former clients or people that you work with, you know, the designated, as I said, clients or patients, because they're the experts. You know, they can give
excellent point.
I always ask them what makes sense to you because, as I said, they're the experts.
There you go. Very good. And it doesn't even have to be somebody you've treated necessarily. It can be somebody that has received service.
Yeah.
That's right. And a good resource for finding that person, if you would prefer not to have maybe a dual relationship with somebody you formerly treated, would be your local community services board. They have certified peer support specialists. They have people that have been in mental health or SA recovery for a long time that are stable that would love to be of assistance. You know, help them work their 12th step. Yeah, it is recovery. It is recovery. Recovery happens. Absolutely. Thank you. So asking somebody, hey, I would love, you know, I value your opinion. I respect you professionally and clinically. And personally, I would like for you to be available to me from time to time, for me to run stuff by to make sure I'm doing things right. You know, that's the ask. And in return, making yourself available to them. What to share and how to share. Now, in my initial, you know, y'all are thinking, God, this guy's pre-relationship therapy session must be like 2 days long. It's really not. I've kind of got it down. But this is another one of the things I cover. I say, I also value quality treatment so much that I have a small circle of other people and professionals that I consult with when I run into a roadblock. You know, I want to make sure you know that. I want to make sure you're okay with that. I don't use names. I don't tell them enough information so that I de-identify the information. I use the context and the dynamics, and I de-identify the information so that the other people that I talk to about this hopefully can't figure it out. So, 45-year-old male that's been married for, 12 years, and, he's dealing with some stress at work, and he's doing this, that, and the other, and, I feel like this, and is that okay, or what do you think, or are there other avenues I should consider? That's what it looks like. That's what to share and how, in my view. Taking and giving feedback on ethical matters. So you need a little bit of ego inoculation, okay? So basically, in the spirit of who's this going to benefit? This is ultimately going to benefit you and the person you're treating, and probably the person that's giving you the consultation, because they're going to learn and grow from it. So being courageous enough, I was talking with somebody earlier about, you know, we know who the pill machine docs are in town, and we're all nicey-nice, and we don't want to blow the whistle on them. People's lives are at stake. The quality of life is at stake. Their care is at stake. So we need to be polite but unvarnished. Does that make sense? We need to be thorough and accurate and on point, but not hostile or derogatory. And, we all know how to do that and need to do that and need to give that feedback. And even if, let's say it's something, and I want to give everybody an out, and we say, I really want to say this to Beth, because, I really think that thing she asked me about, I was just like, my head almost spun around, and, she's like so far off track, I'm just not even sure I can begin to speak to it. Maybe saying, I've got some real concerns about how you're handling this case, and I just want to make sure you're open to hearing some stuff, and, kind of starting slow and chunking it, and then, getting it out there, because, it's dangerous to put yourself out there like that in a way. I mean, people get offended and hurt feelings, and they defriend you on Facebook, and, all this stuff happens, And so, but taking it seriously enough that it is unvarnished, but it's sincere and authentic, and it's about safety and value and quality of life. Documenting, and this is, I alluded to this earlier, when I do an ethics consultation, I do retain a separate file that I do actually keep forever in case anything happens, because I figure anything that can put me in jail or take my license, I want to hold on to. And so I have a folder that I call situations. So it's innocuous enough that, anyway, that's the title of my little folder. That's my little funny. Yeah, that's right. Figure it'd take them a couple days to find that, and Beth will probably get it in the incinerator first. But I do. I just make some notes. The patients almost in a psychotherapy note manner. Okay, you guys familiar with that? It's separate and protected from legal disclosure and everything. And talk about what I did and what my concerns were, and who I talked to. I talked to Bill W. and he said this, and he's a LCSW. And I talked to Beth C. and she said this, and she's LPC. And I talked to this RN, and then this was my thought process, and then this was my conclusion, this is what I did. And that's great. And God, you talk about insurance. I mean, if anything hits the fan and the board comes knocking on your door and you can produce that, I think they would be like, you're good. Or at least that would take the sting out of whatever they did do. And if you go do all that and you really mess up, then you deserve what you get. But I think that'll keep you, that's a protective factor for practicing ethically. I'll put it like that. So here's my favorite part, percolating, deciding, and acting. So you gotten the feedback, let it percolate, always sleep on stuff unless it's life or death, 911, emergency type thing. Making your decision, doing your documentation, and then carrying out your decision and acting on it. And I have shared with folks I was treating, I said, this issue, we've got here that we've been wrestling with, that I've been wrestling with, don't do that. I cared so much, I just want you to know that I took it to my ethics consult team, which is made up of, depending on who it is at the time, an RN and a psychologist and a behavioral health specialist and folks like that. And this is what, this was what their feedback was, in abbreviated format, and this is what I've decided to do. People are really touched by that because you cared enough to go that extra mile. So that's kind of the manifestation of building that ethics consult team and what to do with it. Oop, there you go again. Okay, so here's your homework. Your challenge if you should choose to accept it. Create or enhance your ethics consultation network. Identify two ethical issues that you deal with each year, every year. That may have a lot to do with the population you work with. That may have something to do with your training, your specialty, your skill set. That may have something to do with who you are as a person. You know what I'm saying? That certain things confront you ethically. But be curious about what those things are. Just think back over the years of the last year, and if you've got amnesia, start this year. And just figure out what are two ethical things that I deal with every year, no matter what. Hopefully you don't deal with that whole laundry list of them that I've been putting up there, but there's probably going to be one or two, maybe more, that just keep coming around. And I have this belief in life that things happen for a purpose, and that what's supposed to happen usually happens eventually, maybe not on our terms, but on somebody's terms, and that a problem or a challenge or an opportunity keeps presenting itself until we make the most of it, or figure it out, or fill in the blank. So in the spirit of that, I think, you know, it's reasonable to see what ethical issues we repeatedly deal with. And then identify and continually reevaluate the ethical issue that most concerns you. And obviously, you know, you may know what that is now, you may need to commit some thought to it, but in the spirit of, you know, you dig your wells before you're thirsty, you figure out what pushes your buttons before it's in your face, so you can plan, anticipate, respond instead of react, be nimble in a professional way. And I'll never know if you do this, but you will. And you'll be richer for it. All right. Wow, I flew through that. So we'll have some good time for questions. We'll have some great time for the case studies. So what I'd like to do, the case studies are on your last page, page 6. So I'll give you guys, this is the group talk, group think thing, time thingy. Remember I talked about it earlier? Okay. Yeah, just kind of talk amongst yourself. Thank you. Read each of these, and you may take some notes, you know, for yourself. And a couple of questions I want you to ask yourself, you know, what are the ethical issues that are present? Maybe you don't think there's ethical issues, okay? And what are possible courses of action? And another one I neglected to put down is, given each case, because there's two that are pretty different, what are questions you need to ask or things you need to think about? Or rocks you need to turn over or things you need to poke with a stick or whatever descriptor you want to put on that activity. So take a few minutes and do that. And if you need to get up, freshen your drink, and remember to tip your bartenders and waitresses. They're working real hard for you.
Are you hearing all
week? I hope not. And I did bring this jacket just to prove to some of you that I own a suit. I did not put it on because you do not want to see a large man melt before your eyes. But I just proof that I have a suit. So, put just the generic topic. So somebody you counseled 6 months ago, great relationship, let's say, terminated services, everybody's happy, everybody wins. They've joined your faith congregation, and lo and behold, they've just started attending this small group that you also attend. And it was intentionally kind of left open-ended right there. So is this an ethical dilemma?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Does anybody not think it is? Anybody brave? Okay. Everybody's brave. Nobody thinks it's not an ethical dilemma. Everybody wins.
We did say it would depend on the kind of group and where they met. Okay,
good.
We still got to consider small anything about it. But
consider, yes.
Absolutely.
That's right. Doesn't mean the goal is not to make it wrong or right. The goal is to think about it and talk about it, yeah. There you go. Okay. So what would be an ethical issue? Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is a really good case example, I think, because it's sort of like it depends kind of thing.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like, this, for example, one of the things I've heard in other ethics trainings, it's called the Farmville exception.
Uh-huh.
You know, that's where you have like this really small town. It's very likely the person who checks out could be your client.
Sure.
It's the only grocery store in town, so what are you going to
do? Well, I mean, that's a little more superficial than sitting there talking about your deep spiritual longings and needs and shortcomings.
Well, it's strictly a Bible study.
Yeah.
It depends on the group. Yes, yeah, so I wrote depends.
So,
okay.
I mean,
so if it's more intense and emotional and sharing and more, then it's whoa.
Or meeting at people's houses versus meeting at the church.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, because that's famous. Yeah, let's go on over to Bobby Sue's. And, okay, now Fred knows where I live.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So. Sure. Thank you. Absolutely. Yeah. Take a sideline with them sometime and say, you know, hey, we're in this group together. Obviously, we go to the same place now, you know, to do our weekly whatever.
I'm in a somewhat similar situation where I go, for instance, not in my group. Uh-huh. They show up from time to time, and they
okay.
were client of mine for two sessions like a year and a half ago.
Right.
And, you know, so again, you know, it's sort of like you can't avoid that. You can't say, look, don't join my.
Or I'm going to deprive myself,
right.
I'm going to deprive you because, yeah, absolutely. Yes, sir, you had your hand up, I'm sorry, and then I'll get to you. Did you have comments?
This happened to her, and she handled it with her usual aplomb.
Okay, wonderful. I don't doubt that.
Well, I had seen someone in emergency services at the hospital. And I was in a small group for about 3 years, really bonded with the group. My husband and I both really liked the group.
Mm-hmm.
And not even thinking this could happen in a church of 2,000 people.
Sure.
The group leader said, we have a new couple coming in, so-and-so, first name. Didn't make any sense to me at all. But when they showed up, it was like, oh.
Yes.
Wow.
So we left the group.
Yeah. You did? Yeah. Okay. And that's, you know, there's no right or wrong answer. I mean, it's just that you were thoughtful.
I think there's a right or wrong.
Yeah.
You do think there's a right or wrong?
Yeah.
Well, as long as at the end of the day, in other words, okay, yeah. So would it have been, well, and you get to say if there's right or wrong, but I think there's a lot of different paths that you could take.
It was
costly. Okay, it was expensive. Okay.
It was costly.
So you gave up something.
It was a loss for us, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. But,
so the next group we joined, we said ahead of time, we need this to be a closed group.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Smart. Yeah. And I think closed groups, you know, lend themselves to a different level of intimacy.
The ethical dilemma was not whether to leave or not. It was how to tell the group leader why we were leaving.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, did you have to? You felt like you probably owed because you were really invested.
We're leaving. Yeah. Yeah.
We've been here for 3 years. We've been real connected to you guys, and we're out.
No, I mean, my job is not to have the right answers. My job is to ask questions. So, you know, I think there's a compulsion to feel an obligation to offer an explanation. But is that, yeah. So it could be different things.
That would
things.
Be another loss.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. Yeah, because then they'd be like, well, do we make you mad?
The friendship is still intact.
That's right.
But it was tricky.
Yeah. I'm just curious, if you don't mind sharing, were you pretty authentic and sincere and honest with what you told them, the reason you were leaving, or?
I talked to the couple in the parking lot.
Okay.
And I told them that we were leaving, but it wasn't because of anything about them other than I wanted them to have, they needed to have a good experience in the group.
Right.
And they said, we don't mind if you're there. It's
and usually,
great if you're
yeah,
there.
It's usually
like,
us
no,
looking out for them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
But with the group leader, I don't think I did it real well.
Okay, what would you do different now?
I don't know.
Okay.
Would
you talk
know.
To more people about it or different people?
I told everybody. No, I'm just kidding.
I don't know. No, I appreciate you being transparent. I really appreciate that because, you know, this is the kind of stuff, this is how we learn, right?
In a bulletin.
I got you. Well, now that sounds like the church that I was raised in because it would have been in the bulletin. So. But anyway.
Actually, I told the group leader that I have seen them professionally and I can't come to the group. And okay. I think that's
sure. Yeah, yeah. It's honest. It's valid.
Was it okay?
You know, if you're asking me my opinion, I think it was okay.
Is it not an ethical violation to disclose that you've seen?
Yeah. Technically, I think
was the person also a dermatologist and she went to him to have some stuff burn off her shoulder? You know what I'm saying? And she just feels weird because they've seen her with her shirt off. I don't know.
The grandparent of somebody else.
Could be anyone.
Lauren just had an idea. Uh-huh. I should have asked the couple first if I could tell the group.
Or maybe ask them, hey, how can I break the news? I owe these people something. 3 years we were together.
Right.
That would have been cool.
That would have been cool.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. There you go. See? Rock on. Yep. Yes, ma'am.
We kind of were talking about, and it kind of follows along that, who has more resources. If someone's
okay.
going to change group, if someone's going to be able to move their schedule around, whether it's an A group or parenting group, whatever the purpose of the group is, who has the ability to go to a different group?
Gotcha.
So if it's the client, they may not know about other groups, they may not have the access to something else where we as a professional might have the opportunity to find another group or find another resource because we're maybe a little more connected.
Great point.
Insurance.
Well, no, I'm talking about when I say small group. I'm sorry, we all think group, you know, therapy. I'm talking about like a Bible study or faith exploration or walk to Emmaus thing or something like that. So, I think you were next.
It did happen to me. It's
okay.
A similar situation.
Okay.
The person that I saw for substance abuse treatment about a year later joined the church and joined a small group, which was a Bible study. So it wasn't any super deep personal sharing. I mean, although there is some of that.
Yeah.
I spoke to him separately and asked him what he wanted me to do, if he was comfortable or not. He said he was very open about being in recovery. I told him I would never identify myself as having been his therapist, but he said, I don't care if people know. I've told people that you're my therapist.
Wow.
Okay. It was his choice, and you know, I shared that with the table and got feedback from someone here that another good thing too that I could have done in addition to that was make it clear to him that if he needed therapy in the future, I would not be comfortable doing that. And
there you go.
I would refer him to somebody else.
There you go.
So
very
I think
good.
That would be another layer there.
Absolutely. Great thinking. Great thinking.
Yes, you're next, and then you're next.
I'm in recovery, and the only reason I share that is because my sponsor family, but my sponsor family does this really large gathering, like once a month, and I used to work here, and there's several people from here that would go to Richmond for sober living, and some of the women that were sponsoring them were in my sponsor family.
Okay.
And so they were at this huge gathering, and it was a lot of personal information that was discussed. So I had talked to my sponsor, and I said, I didn't identify any of the clients. I said, I have former patients that are going to be coming here, and I'm not comfortable coming here to talk about this. And I had a lot of crap thrown at me, not from my sponsor, but from other women.
In the group,
they're like, well, you have the right to be here. I said, no, I don't. Ethically, I have to put that first. Because I can still go to other meetings.
That's right. You get to say
I can still talk to my sponsor alone. I can still do all these other things. I don't have to come to this group. And I opted out.
There you go. It's your perfect
part. But it's also your comfort level, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, but I had it, and you're right, but I had a situation where my sponsor said, look, just come, it's a lot smaller, and I walk in, and damn if I want to see a client. But the look she had on her face when she saw me was like, oh, you know, and I walked up to her, and I said, I'll leave. Because you have the right to be here. And she kept saying, no, 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 I want you to stay.
But
I felt like
body
a monkey screwing a football. I was like, I can't. I was not okay with that.
Right.
I just
and
wasn't.
At the end of the day, you got to be okay with the decisions you make. At the end of the day, you
okay.
did.
And people will say they're okay when really they're not okay.
And they're really
right.
not.
They feel like that's the
exactly.
right thing to say. But there was a question or a comment. Yes, ma'am.
I was just going to say that I was thinking of it in some ways where what if you can't? So
you mean you don't have the resource to go somewhere else?
So like for instance, I live and I work with my patients every day.
Okay.
Which means that it's constantly those dual relationships, multiple relationships. And so the key is really setting those boundaries and having those discussions.
Great observation. And some of us are in that Farmville syndrome, or I think was mentioned, or something different or similar, yeah. And you know, it's we can't eliminate it, so we have to manage it.
Well, it can be an awesome learning opportunity about boundaries.
Yeah.
To have the open conversation about what's right here.
That's right.
You know, what's here right now with us, the elephant, if you will, in the room, as it were. And because a lot of times people are needing to learn boundaries, and that's a great way to teach them right
it
in
is.
The moment.
Absolutely. That's on-the-job training right there.
And reinforces for us and teaches them.
That's right. And it shows, I think it's respectful, and it's kind of like saying, namaste to them in the therapy. You know, I mean, it's just kind of cool and righteous. And, you know, I think somebody mentioned earlier that you did, you were saying, well, they were cool with it. And they were like telling everybody I was their therapist and stuff. And isn't that always the way it is? The people we treat, you know, they're fine with it. We're the ones that are like, you know, uptight or whatever about it. But we have to be because the onus is on us. We have to be, you know. So anyway, good. Okay, I think there's one. Yes.
Similar situation where someone came to my church of a thousand.
Okay. They could be safe there, but no.
They went into my small group. And I looked at them, I don't think so. And so the following Sunday, I happened to see the person before group time. And I said, you know, I don't think it's fair to you for me to be there. He said, I sense you were uncomfortable.
Nice.
He said, I'm going somewhere else.
Nice.
Had he not said that, and I told him, I said, please don't do that because of me. If you want to stay, please stay. I will go elsewhere.
You gave him the option. He opted out. Very good. And that's respectful.
And the following week, he was involved in a few crazy things, and it was in the newspaper. His name.
Oh,
Charlie.
Oh,
and all that. Oh, well.
Yeah. Yeah, that's something. That's cool. Okay.
A whole other group, but that's
cool. Yeah, that's a whole. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anything else on this first case today before we move on to the second one? Great work, guys. Now this is the kind of stuff. This is where I learned. So I thank you for it, because I certainly don't have all the answers. I just
you know, the older I get, the more I realize how much more I have to learn. I think it was Michelangelo when he was 90 said, "Ancora imparo," which means I am still learning in Italian. Kind of cool. So the second one, a new patient seems to need more sessions than their old insurance will allow. And you only have 4 sessions left. And you know what's coming. You know that you were allocated blah sessions for X disorder under Y terms. And they want to continue with you. And, you know, you've begun to, you know, you've been very cognizant and proactive and begun to do, you know, I think discharge planning begins the day you begin services. They wish to continue, and they have just begun to make some real progress. Is this an ethical issue potentially or on its face? Okay, it is an ethical issue. Hands down ethical issue. Okay, absolutely. Okay. So what are some of the things that we could do as the treating provider there? Well, what could we do? 4 sessions left. Person needs more than that. That's not fair. It does depend on where you were. So let's pick a name of place and let's dig into that.
If you look at your local CFP, you can't just be like, "Oh, I'm going to see you without insurance privately in my private practice." You have to be like, "Well, you know, this is where I work. You have to pay Columbia Rural Health."
Okay.
There might not be options to treat them.
Okay.
Separately.
So it depends on where you work. So. And then I think we were talking earlier too. I had a sideline conversation with somebody. You know, you've got to be. I think she left actually. So had a better offer. So you, it does depend, and you have to figure out where you come down on that. Are you willing to sacrifice your job or make conscriptions to your ethics? And I don't think it's unethical to adhere to the policies of the place that you work, but I think, you know, pre-planning, informed consent to the person about that, referring them to somebody that could see them. Maybe there's, you know, some dummy that takes cash payments and does gratis patients sometimes, or a lot of the time, that you can pawn them off on. Transfer them to. What else could you do?
Maybe there's other resources that are available to help.
Okay. Other resources. I mean, are other places, bless you? I'm not aware, but are there places that, like, say you have Anthem and you've run out of sessions and you're destitute to pay privately anybody, and you go to another, I mean, is there somebody that'll see you under those terms, or can you just, like, tell your patient to fib and say, "Look, I don't have any insurance, here's my paycheck stub, slide and fee me, slide and scale me"?
You can move to slide and
scale. I think this is one that depends on the situation. So, for example, I've been a client, co-dependency, for 3 years. She's bipolar 1, borderline personality disorder, as post-traumatic stress disorder.
Oh, okay. Wow, congratulations. Great.
So, and she's, unlike a lot of borderlines, she's this lovable of get out. And she doesn't bond easily. So it's like, so for me, and she's going to run out of her secondary, so she's got Medicare. So in this situation, transference is strong enough that if I referred her out, she would experience that as a wound from abandonment. So basically, what I would do with her if that ever happened is I would just work out a fee arrangement. Even if she didn't like pay $5 a week, I would take $5 a week, because given the nature of this relationship, I'm not calling this a rule, but given that relationship, given the transferences involved and the issues, that I feel like I have a professional obligation to see her, not abandon her in that situation.
So did you do, I'm going to be unvarnished now for a minute. Did you do the pre-relationship conversation about your insurance may run out and what are we going to do then, and I may need to transfer you to somebody else, or I may need to see you to tide you over to transfer you to somebody that can see you with the resources you have now? You happen to be gracious enough to be that person, but did you have any conversation like that?
The truth is no.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't.
I know. However, my ethical policy, whether I express it or not, is not to abandon patients.
Absolutely.
And if they feel like they would rather see somebody else in their circumstances, I would just get them to the best team practitioner available.
So basically, that answers the same question I was going to say. Would you cut that same deal to anybody that you treat?
Depending on the circumstances, but sure, I would not.
So let me just. Let me ask it this way. So her having abandonment issues, is that would you want to make that a part of your work with her, so that she didn't, in other words, so that she was sturdy enough emotionally to handle that.
Yeah, and with the idea that the point that she's ready to wean away mm-hmm. from our work, yeah, we could do that, but that would be a natural part of the relationship.
Right.
Money won't be a primary issue.
I mean, no client in their right mind that has seen you for 3 years with those diagnoses is going to want to leave the relationship. No client in their wrong mind, even.
Yeah, exactly.
Not anytime soon.
Right.
But you know,
maybe not ever.
But I like what you said. I want to fold in what you said, because that's a damn good point.
Yeah.
It's like we deal with termination from session one.
Yeah. I
so
think
the
so.
Idea is I'm not here to be there forever.
That's right.
I may die someday.
That's right. Yeah.
I'm retired.
Yeah.
Right. So putting that in as an expectation of things forever
good.
Becomes part of the dynamic.
Excellent. Beautiful. And that's so important with folks with the Access 2 Cluster B is that you sturdy them up, you inoculate them as best you can to not you know, divorce themselves from that diagnostic cluster, but to help them better manage it, to help them better manage what it means to them.
Mm-hmm.
I've had folks come to see me and say, and by the way, I've got borderline personality disorder, and I say, so how's that going to impact our relationship? And they just go, well, you're just supposed to just like run screaming from the room when I say that. I mean, I've never had anybody respond to me that way. And I'm just like, I'm curious. I'm like, so what of it? So, yeah, that's right. Very good. Other thoughts? Yes, ma'am.
Yes. And there is something that really bothers me
okay. When
someone is told your insurance allows X number of benefits, hurry up and get better.
Mm-hmm. No, actually, it abhors me, yeah.
And on the flip side of that, I was involved in a serious car accident in which my car was totaled. That I'm alive is a miracle. But when I went to physical therapy, and I will not name where, their policy was get you better and out in 3 months. I was way beyond that. And I tried to tell them, you are pushing me too hard and too fast. I cannot do this. And when I passed out on them, it finally dawned on them. And then they wanted to get me into a special clinic to be seen by a doctor, et cetera. And I told that doctor, do what you must, but get me out of here because I will never get down here.
Good for you, yeah. And you know, the not to vilify insurance any more than they vilify themselves, but that's the way that, you know, that I'm glad you used the physical therapy example because it is throughout, you know, healthcare. It's not just behavioral health. I mean, I think behavioral health gets maybe a little bit more of a brunt of it sometimes than the more, you know, hard sciences where you can get an x-ray and say, this vertebrae is cracked, you need X, Y, and Z. And we're like, well, you know, these are the symptoms. And they're like, oh, really? You know, you just want to chat with them, have a cup of coffee. Yeah. Anyway, have a little bit of healthy paranoia about how insurance companies view our craft. So, yeah, it is. It really is. Absolutely. Thank you for that. Yeah. Other thoughts on this? Running out of session. What else could you do? One thing that hadn't been brought up, you could call the insurance company and appeal.
Yeah.
Well, you can always do that.
I just have to guess.
Otherwise, that's the first thing you do.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, I didn't say that, so. Yeah, but yeah, no, okay, good. Assume. So I'll just, you know, just because it's not up there and, you know, you could appeal it. You can write letters. You can talk to their PCP. Sometimes the PCP call in is carry more weight than the behavioral health specialist professional. Let's see. You can. That can happen. That can legitimately, authentically happen. I'm not talking about diagnostic fabrication here. I'm talking about That's absolutely. That's absolutely. That's absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. That's a good point. Look for another diagnosis. Anything else?
How often does this actually happen? Other than EAPs, I have never had an insurance company say we're done.
Medicaid, you know, Medicaid 26 sessions
Medicaid.
A year. Okay, there you go.
That's why.
26 sessions a year, and then you can get it renewed one time, and then after that, good luck to you.
But not other than Medicaid, anyone else?
Is anybody else? I mean, I've had it happen with a couple that I won't name, but. Yeah, and I was very confident in my diagnosis that it was sufficient and accurate. It wasn't overkill and it wasn't minimization either. And I've had it happen, and yeah, I just had to do the best I could.
It used to happen more often than it does now.
Maybe so. I mean, I haven't dealt with insurance in about 3 years. So, yeah, well, I'm not bragging. I'm maybe complaining. I don't know. But I remember those used to be nice to get those little electronic fund transfers. I used to like that. So other comments on this? That may be all we can poke this with a stick.
I think what you said about having a policy.
Uh-huh.
So you have a policy, you know, as a proactive measure. What would I do?
Absolutely.
How would I handle this? Even in our program with substance abuse and individuals are self-pay, we have a financial hardship policy.
Sure.
To try and be fair amongst everybody. In the ideal that someone at one time would have a hardship.
Sure.
You know, so that policy is in place and gives us structure again.
That's right. And the folks you treat know that. Exactly. That's beautiful. And that's a great protective measure for this type of dilemma. A lot of people in private practice aren't financially able to do that or don't do that or choose not to do that or whatever. But, you know, yeah. Okay. Cool. Very cool. Others? Yes, sir.
There's also, I mean, subset, but there are some resources like Given Hour, for example.
Okay.
Yes. Where you can get free, you have to be a vet for active duty or a vet.
Yeah. So policy for indigent, is that what you're?
It's called Given Hour. It's for veterans or people who are active duty, and the service is free.
Okay. There you go. So linking them with that or doing that yourself, actually. Okay, very good. Great job, guys. Great job. Enjoyed it. Fun. Cool. Do your homework. Thank you so much. I will, thank you. Appreciate that. Those $20 bills I taped under your chairs really worked.